It says in Isaiah 53, verse 5, but he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. You know, so many times when people look at the concept of religion, they see it as this journey to make themselves like God or to make themselves acceptable to God. So a lot of people, when we talk about this journey to awakening, we see it as this journey of self-discovery, this journey of self-perfection, this journey of entering into a set and series of disciplines so that we can be accepted by a God or accepted by God or accepted by the adherents of a particular kind of religion. But Christianity is actually radically different from any other religion in the sense that Christianity is not an invitation to enter into a journey of self-betterment. You say it's not, like, no, it really isn't. Christianity is really this incredible story of the Christ. Christianity is really not about you or me. It's all about his story, right? Like even the word history, it's two words. It's his story. And so many times when people, when humanity approaches the religious conversation, the religious narrative, we use the concept of divinity as a self-hacking mechanism in order to step into the us that we've always wanted to be. And why? Usually because of some sort of fear mechanism. There's this place where we don't want to be rejected by people and we don't want to reject ourselves. And so our religion just becomes no different than our gym membership. It's this place where we are exerting a tremendous amount of effort in order to achieve the better us. And a lot of people, that is their concept of Christianity. And it is a false concept. It is a false construct for what Christianity really is. Christianity is he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon him. By his stripes, we are healed. True Christianity, it's always taking our attention, our focus, our obsession from ourselves and onto him. True Christianity is always this place of conversion and converting us from self-worship to the worship and the exaltation of who he is. We see in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21, that he who knew no sin became sin so that we could become the righteousness of Christ, that he in his perfection became all of our imperfection so that we could take on his perfection. Isn't that incredible? That's absolutely incredible. You know, Buddha, before he died, said, strive without ceasing. Jesus, just before he died, hung on the cross and declared, it is finished. That's a bold claim. Why? Because this is what Jesus is saying. Jesus is saying, hey, what I am doing right now, it is enough. Listen, every person should listen right now that what Jesus did on the cross, that it was enough. That what Jesus did on the cross, it was enough for all of your sins, for everything that you, like, listen, that Christianity is not this place where we self-atone for our, like, when we try to do that, we are actually negating, we are actually subverting this incredible, costly love sacrifice that was made for us. And this is where it's somewhat confusing because our whole lives, we're always told, act your age. Our whole lives are always told and taught how to perform in such a way so that we won't get rejected. But now all of a sudden, when you read the Bible and you read the gospel, you actually see this story where Jesus actually accepts people before they've even changed, that Jesus loves people before they've made themselves better. In fact, Jesus wasn't looking for people to make themselves better. Jesus was just looking for people who would be honest enough to acknowledge who they are without any sort of coverings, without any sort of false pretenses. Like there's something about just brutal honesty that was so attractive to Jesus, but there was something that Jesus found incredibly repulsive, and that was pride. And one of the most things that Jesus found, like the most repulsive thing to Jesus, was religious pride. Listen, religious pride will keep you from a relationship with God. It will keep you from a relationship with Jesus. Religious pride will only bring you into this place of self-exaltation, this place where you find your elevation through your achievements, through your moral achievements, through your political achievements. Listen, Christianity is not a journey of self-exaltation, and nor is it a journey of self-brutalization and a place of self-torture and self-condemnation. Christianity is this incredible story that he was wounded, that he was bruised, that it was because of his incredible sacrifice. It is because of Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. The journey to awakening, it begins when we are willing to see that Jesus is a sufficient Savior. Hey, let's say that together. Let's declare. You might be in a room watching this with other people. I don't care. I want you just to declare this out loud. And let's say it like this. Jesus is my sufficient Savior. Is that good? One, two, three. Jesus is my sufficient Savior. We don't need anything else except him. Jesus is really all that you need. You know, so many times we have so many excuses for so many things that we need. We need a new job. We need a new spouse. We need a new car. We need a new church. We need a new pastor. Like, listen, Jesus is all that you need. In him, you can find whatever you need to find. The second thing is that our Father is a good Father. You see, a lot of times when people look at the cross and people see Jesus hanging there, they see him hanging alone, and they see Jesus as this victimized son. Listen, Jesus was a victim of injustice, but Jesus never took on a victim mentality. Why? Because Jesus was not murdered. No, no, no. He gave his life for us. He gave his life because of love for his Father and love for all of humanity. That Jesus did not hang alone, that Jesus hung in this incredible dance, in this incredible waltz, in this incredible collaboration of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. That Jesus never once split off from the Holy Trinity. That there on the cross, we see this incredible love story of the Father, the Son, the Spirit, and this rescue mission, riding divinity into the plot line of the jacked upness of humanity. And there on the cross, in this moment of total, complete defeat. And yet, what everybody was seeing as total and complete defeat was actually this place of triumph. It was this place of victory. That the cross is not a place of defeat, that the cross is a place of victory. In the same way, a lot of times when we look at our own lives of being honest and being vulnerable and taking off all the false pretenses and getting rid of all of the religious pride and all of the performance in order to get people to like us, when we can just take off all of our masks and just be raw and real and in this place, we might think that's total defeat. That might look like the cross. That might look like this is just completely embarrassing. And yet, when we can come to the end of ourselves and when we don't have to pretend and we don't have to play any sort of games, we don't have to act religious, we don't have to act like a Christian. Listen, Jesus does not want you to act like a Christian. Jesus doesn't want you to pretend like you've got your act together. That comes out of religious pride, and that is very anti-Christian. There was no acting on the cross. There was nakedness. There was shame. There was scorn. There was embarrassment. It was humiliation. There was no makeup on the cross. It was just real stinking life. And this is true Christianity, the cross. And this is where it all begins. That place of getting absolutely real and raw and vulnerable in this place where I'm just going to come to God exactly for who I am with this huge, huge mess. And in this place, I'm going to believe that Jesus is sufficient, that my Father is a good, good Father, that I will not hang alone, that I will not suffer alone, that He will not leave me in this place of just shame, of wallowing in my own depravity, that Jesus did not hang on the cross alone. And when you find yourself at the end of your rope, when you find yourself in this place where you're like, you're just, you stinking had it, and you're not going to just do you're not just going to play the game anymore. When you find yourself really saying, I need saving, I need a Savior, that you will not be alone. There in that place, you will find the Son, the Father, the Spirit, the three in one. And you might think it's the end of your story. You might think this is the end of your life. But the cross is not the end of the story. The cross was just the beginning. And I don't know what you're going through, but this is not the end of your story. This is just the beginning. And I don't know what people are telling you. And I don't know what accountants are telling you. I don't know what other corporations are telling you. I don't know what anybody's telling you. This is what I'm telling you. This is not the end. This is only the beginning. That people looked at the cross and said it's a place of defeat. It was not defeat. It was victory. And you might think that you're defeated right now, but you are not defeated, right? That if you can come into this place of belief and acknowledgement, you're just like, acknowledgement, what are you talking about? I think that this is a very important part of the story, that as Jesus hung on the cross, there were two thieves. One thief hung on the cross in his place of pride and in his place of arrogance. He died. He died a lonely, embarrassing death while hanging right next to God in flesh, Emmanuel, God with us, that a thief died right next to Jesus, and he died because of pride. And yet there was another thief there, and the thief on the other side says to Jesus, this is Luke 23, verses 42, 43, he says, Jesus, hey, remember me when you come into your kingdom. This is the thief comes, like, there's no more pretense, right? He's like, this is the end of my story, and I can at least have enough humility to acknowledge who I am going to die beside. And he looks over at Jesus and he says, hey, look, I know this is the end of my story. I know that I am dying the death of a thief. And he says, hey, but when you die, this is the only thing I ask, that you remember me. And Jesus turns and looks at him and says, truly, I tell you the truth. Jesus says, I tell you the truth. Can you imagine Jesus looking over at you like you've never been a religious man, you've never been a righteous person, you weren't the temple guy, you were the one stealing from the temple kind of guy. Can you imagine living your whole life and now you're about to die and you can't prove nothing. You ain't going to make yourself better. You ain't going to read some sort of self-improvement book. Man, this is the end of your stinking story. And you look over at Jesus and you're like, all I'm asking is that you'll remember me. And this is what Jesus says. Not only will I remember you, but today you will join me in paradise. And this is the most incredible thing, that just mere humility and just acknowledgement that can bring about the radical salvation that you need. Sometimes we overcomplicate everything and we say that salvation looks like saying a sinner's prayer or saying some sort of magical kind of thing. And there's nothing wrong with the sinner's prayer. There's nothing wrong with going up front at a church service. And I love all of that. But listen, I'll tell you, that moment of salvation comes when something inside of your heart ignites. This is the work of the Holy Spirit. When you hear somebody saying something, and maybe I'm saying something right now, and for the first time in your life, it's not just some sort of religious banter, but now it's got juice on it, and now it's got life on it. For the very first time, it's like something religious actually makes sense. It's like it's no longer religious. You can now sense the tugging. You can now feel God's heart himself like summoning you and your heart. And that's the Holy Spirit. It's the Spirit that brings forth revelation, the revealing of hidden things. And in this place, we can humble ourselves and we can step into a public acknowledgement. This is what the thief did. In this place of total mockery, the thief said out loud, I believe. I believe. I'm not expecting anything in return. I'm not expecting salvation. I just want to say, well, in the midst of all of this, I believe. And what Jesus does is he responds by extending salvation and giving him access into paradise for all of eternity. Luke chapter 12, verse 8 to 10 says this, "And I tell you, everyone who acknowledges me before men, the Son of Man will also acknowledge me before the angels of God. But the one who denies me before men will be denied before the angels of God. And everyone who speaks a word against the Son of Man will be forgiven. But the one who blasphemes against the Holy Spirit will not be forgiven." This is what he's talking about here. This place of acknowledgement. This place of saying, hey, I may have been a certain way, but today everything is changing. And let me just say this. Hey, you may have been a certain way, but today everything can change. Not because of your potential, but because of Jesus, because of what he did on the cross. Listen, this is not some sort of self-affirmation Friday night where I'm going to tell you you're good enough, you're smart enough, and if you do the right things, people will like you. That's not the point of this service. The point of this service is this. God is good. And God is good enough. And what needed to happen happened 2,000 years ago. And it's not about if you can tap dance and if you can perform, then one day you can be saved. The truth is this, you were saved 2,000 years ago. It's just perhaps your heart hasn't been illuminated. You haven't discovered what has happened and you haven't responded. You haven't acknowledged Jesus. And tonight is your night. And you don't have to do nothing at home. You don't have to whatever. This is about you and God. This is you and your creator. Knowing this, you've been created for such a time as this. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. And throughout your whole life, throughout all the pain of the past, and all the stuff that has happened, there has been a pursuit from eternity to capture the very core of who you are. And I believe that even tonight, that the Father is pursuing you. That this is about an incredible journey to awakening, a journey where God became man, journeyed from heaven to earth, who lived and died, who suffered because of love for you and I. And as you may or may not know, he didn't remain dead. And if you might feel dead, but you're not gonna remain dead. You know, on Sunday, we're gonna celebrate his resurrection power, his resurrection life, the fact that Jesus rose again on the third day. And let me just tell you this, that we're not here to just glory in death, but we do know that there's only one way into life, and that's through death. And so tonight would be a good night to die. Tonight would be a good night to die to yourself. Tonight would be a good night to die to pride and religious pride, to striving, to trying to make yourself better. Tonight would be a good night for you to say, I'm done. I'm done with all of that spiritual manipulation. And tonight I'm going to go to simple confession and I'm going to confess Jesus as my Lord and Savior. If you're willing, would you pray that with me right now? If God is pursuing you, would you make tonight this very special night, like in the midst of everything that the world is going through, that the nations, that our country, that all of us are going through right now, maybe tonight is your night when you begin your journey of awakening. And if that's you, then just pray with me right now. Let's all pray this together. Just say, Jesus, I acknowledge you. And I declare a death to my old self, death to my old ways of thinking, death to my old ways of living. I don't want to be religious. I want to be a son. So tonight, I acknowledge you and I acknowledge my dependence, my need of a Savior. I receive you tonight. I receive your love for me tonight. Now just let him come to you. Let him receive you. And know this, that you are a son, you are a daughter, and he is pleased with you. You haven't had an opportunity to do anything yet. You haven't had an opportunity to prove anything yet, because it's not about that. You, right now, the present you, not the future you, the present you are deeply loved because of Jesus. God bless you. Thank you for taking the time to be a part of this celebration of the death of Christ. Join us on Sunday as we celebrate his life and resurrection. And thank you for just being real tonight. Thank you for just being raw and honest and open and processing through this with the Holy Spirit. I don't even know who's watching this, but he knows. And I believe that something has been accomplished tonight. Something radical, something powerful, and something eternal has taken place here tonight. You are loved. God bless you.